Morning students, today we are going to start with microbes in production of biogas. Already this topic somewhat we have discussed. Production, it is occurring in two steps of primary and secondary. Primary and secondary, that already we had discussed the certain topics related with this one. I will say one more time that primary treatment and secondary treatment. Microbes in sewage treatment. Last topic we have studied is microbes in sewage treatment. We know that large quantities of waste water are generated every day in cities and towns. And how that is treated? Two methods are there, two steps are there for this method, primary and secondary. So primary treatment, this topic already we had learned that is somewhat related with the next topic, so I am saying one more time. These treatment steps basically involve physical removal of particle. Physical removal only, not chemical action is not there, only physical removal of particle, that is large and small particles are removed, large and small particles. Through which method only? Filtration and sedimentation. Through filtration and sedimentation. These are removed in stages. Initially, floating debris is removed by sequential filtration only. These are removed in stages. Initially, floating debris is removed by sequential filtration. Then the grit are removed by sedimentation. Then the grit are removed by sedimentation. All solids that is settled from the primary sludge and the supernatant forms the effluent only. All solids that is settled from the primary sludge and the supernatant forms the effluent. The effluent from the primary settling tank is taken for secondary treatment. The effluent from the primary settling tank is taken for the secondary. The remaining liquid is called effluent. That effluent is taken to the secondary treatment. So secondary treatment of biological, the primary, this is biological treatment only. Primary treatment is physical treatment only, and secondary treatment is biological treatment, means living organism are using to treat. The primary effluent is passed into large aeration tanks, aeration tank, air also providing, where it is constantly agitated and mechanically and air is pumped into it. This allow vigorous growth of useful aerobic microbes into flocks. Flocks means masses of bacteria associated with the fungal filaments to form mesh-like structures only. Masses of bacteria associated with fungal filaments to form mesh-like structures. While growing, these microbes consume the major part of the organic matter in the effluent. While growing, these microbes consumes the major part of the organic matter in the effluent. This significantly reduces the BOD, that is biochemical oxygen demand. Because this whole organism are consuming oxygen dissolved in water only, aquatic oxygen only. Oxygen dissolved in water. As a result, what will be happened? The amount of oxygen is decreasing in water. Why it is decreasing? How much organism are growing, according to that, the oxygen will be decreased in the water. That is called BOD, biochemical oxygen demand. This significantly reduces the BOD of the effluent. BOD refers, BOD is an important term only, so one more time. BOD refers to the amount of oxygen that would be consumed if all the organic matter in 1 liter of water were oxidized by bacteria. BOD refers to the amount of the oxygen. BOD refers to the amount of the oxygen that would be consumed if all the organic matter in 1 liter of water were oxidized by bacteria. The sewage water is treated till the BOD is reduced. The sewage water is treated till the BOD is reduced. BOD is reduced. The BOD test measures the rate of uptake of oxygen by microorganism. If BOD decreased, means that this bacteria is consuming much oxygen in a sample of water, and thus indirectly BOD is a measure of the organic matter. BOD is the measure of the organic matter present in the water. The greater the BOD of wastewater, more is its polluting potential. BOD is a measure of the organic matter present in the water, the greater the BOD of wastewater, more is its pollutant potential. Once the BOD of sewage or wastewater is reduced significantly, the effluent is then passed into a settling tank where the bacterial flocks, group of mass of bacteria is called bacterial flocks, are allowed to sediment. Sediment means depositing in the bottom. The sediment is called activated sludge only. This sediment which is settled at the bottom is called activated sludge. A small part of the activated sludge is pumped back into the aeration tank to serve as the inoculum for the next process. From that activated sludge, a small portion is pumped back into the aeration tank to serve as the inoculum. The remaining major part of the sludge is pumped into large tanks called anaerobic sludge digesters. Anaerobic sludge digesters. Here, other kinds of bacteria which grow anaerobically digest the bacteria and the fungi in the sludge. During this digestion, bacteria produce a mixture of gases such as methane, hydrogen sulfide, and carbon dioxide. Methane, hydrogen sulfide, and carbon dioxide. These gases form biogas and can be used as source of energy as it is inflammable. These gases form biogas and can be used as source of energy as it is inflammable only. Inflammable means giving heat. The effluent from the secondary treatment plant is generally released into natural water bodies like rivers and streams only. This much portion already we have covered. In this, this portion is very important. So one more time I told that in that BOD also separately asked the sewage treatment also many times asked. So now we are, you can appreciate how microbes play a major role in treating millions of gallons of wastewater. So we have to appreciate the microbes for their work. See that how microbes play a major role in treating millions of gallons of wastewater. How microbes play a major role in treating millions of gallons of wastewater every day across the globe. This methodology has been practiced for more than a century now in almost all parts of the world. Till date, no man-made technology has been able to rival the microbial treatment of sewage. Till date, no man-made technology has been able to rival the microbial treatment of sewage. You are aware that due to increasing urbanization, sewage is being produced in much larger quantities than ever before. However, the number of sewage treatment plants has not increased enough to treat such large quantities of water. So the untreated sewage is often discharged sometimes. So the untreated sewage is often discharged directly into rivers, leading to their pollution and increase in waterborne disease. So due to increasing urbanization, urbanization means city formation. Village area is converted into city. Sewage is being produced in much larger quantities only because of the urbanization. So than ever. However, the number of sewage treatment plant is not so much. So what it is doing? Untreated sewage is often discharged directly into rivers, leading to their pollution and increase in waterborne diseases. The Ministry of Environment and Forest has initiated Ganga Action Plan and Yamuna Action Plan to save the major rivers of our country from pollution. Under these plans, it is proposed to build a large number of sewage treatment plants so that only treated sewage may be discharged in the rivers. Only treated sewage only discharged into the rivers. Otherwise, it causes many water causing diseases. Waterborne diseases are causing it. Untreated sewage is putting like that in the water, it can cause many waterborne diseases. So some diagrams related to that also given. This one, an aerial view of sewage plant. Aerial view from where it is taken. Sewage plant. So now we are going to the new plant. New one, microsynth production of biogas. Are you heard about biogas? Biogas is a mixture of gases only. Mixture of gases. Already we had learned in that sewage treatment plant. So one more time I told that biogas is a mixture of gases containing predominantly methane produced by the microbial activity. Produced by the microbial activity and which may be used as fuel. You have learned that microbes produce different types of gaseous end products. Microbes produce different types of gaseous end products during growth and metabolism. During growth and metabolism. During their growth, different type of gaseous end products they are producing. Microbes produce different types of gaseous end products during growth and metabolism. The type of the gas produced depends upon the microbes. The type of the gas produced depends upon the microbes and the organic substrates they utilize. In the examples cited, in relation to fermentation or dough, cheese making and production of beverages, the main gas produced was carbon dioxide. So during their life cycle, at many times these microbes are producing gases as the end products of their metabolic reactions. The type of the gas produced depends upon the microbes also. Different microbes are there, bacteria, fungus, protozoa, like that different microbes are there and the organic substrate they utilize. The type of the gas produced depends upon the microbes and the organic substrate they utilize. It depends upon two things only, microbes and organic substrate they utilize. In the example cited in relation to fermentation of dough, cheese making and production of beverages. In the example cited, in relation to fermentation of dough, cheese making and production of beverages, the main gas produced was CO2. The main gas produced was CO2. However, certain bacteria which grow anaerobically on cellulosic material produce large amount of methane along with the carbon dioxide and the along with the carbon dioxide and the water, carbon dioxide and hydrogen. Certain bacteria which grow anaerobically on cellulose, anaerobic respiration without the use of oxygen, anaerobically on cellulose material. So material also important and the microbe also important. All these two factors only which gas should be produced is depending upon which is the microbe and which is the oxidizing material. So here bacteria is the organism and it grow anaerobically on material is cellulose only. Anaerobically on cellulosic material produce large amount of methane. Which gas is producing? Methane along with the carbon dioxide and the hydrogen. These bacteria are collectively called methanogens. These bacteria are collectively called methanogens. And one such a common bacterium is methanobacterium. One such a common bacterium is methanobacterium. These bacteria are commonly found in the anaerobic sludge during sewage treatment. These bacteria are commonly found in the anaerobic sludge during sewage treatment. These bacteria are also present in the rumen. Rumen is a part of stomach. So these bacteria are also present in the rumen. Ruminate animal like that, cow like that, on the sudden all the food are eating together and storing inside the stomach. And afterwards it takes the food again from the stomach and chewing. Like that animal is called a ruminate animal. So they have a part inside the stomach which will store this food. That part is called a rumen. So the bacteria are also present in rumen of cattle. A lot of cellulosic material present in the food of cattle is also present in the rumen. Cellulosic material also. Cellulose is very difficult to digest. In rumen, these bacteria help in the breakdown of cellulose and play an important role in the nutrition of cattle. So do you think we human beings are able to digest the cellulose present in our foods? Thus the excreta of cattle, commonly called gobar, is rich in this bacteria. This bacteria is present there. So cellulosic, they can be digested cellulose, but we cannot be digested the cellulose. During dung can be used for generation of biogas, commonly called gobar gas. Commonly called gobar gas. So biogas is a mixture of gases produced by the microbial activity and which may be used as fuel. You have learned that microbes produce different types of gaseous end products during growth and metabolism. The type of the gas produced depend upon the microbes and the organic substance they utilize. Examples: in relation to fermentation of dough, cheese making, and production of beverages, the main gas produced was carbon dioxide. In these three situations, which are the three? Fermentation of dough, cheese making, and production of beverages, the main gas produced was carbon dioxide only. In fermentation of dough, cheese making, and production of beverages. However, certain bacteria which grow anaerobically on cellulosic material. Produce large amount of methane. Along with the carbon dioxide and the hydrogen. Anaerobically on cellulosic material produce large amount of methane along with the carbon dioxide and the hydrogen. These bacteria are collectively called methanogens. And one such common bacterium is methanobacterium. So from this example, you understood that the gas produced is depending upon the microbe and the material they are using. The bacteria are commonly found in anaerobic sludge during sewage treatment. These bacteria are also present in the rumen of the cattle only. Rumen is a part of stomach that already told in the cattle only. It is not present in human being. Cattle, ruminate animals only it is present. A lot of cellulosic material present in the food of cattle is also present in the rumen. In rumen, these bacteria help in the breakdown of cellulose and play an important role in the nutrition of cattle. Do you think we human beings are able to digest the cellulose? No, we cannot digest because this bacteria is not present in our stomach. Thus, the excreta of cattle, commonly called the gobar, is rich in the bacteria. Dung can be used for generation of biogas, commonly called the gobar gas. The biogas plant consists of a concrete tank. In which bio waste are collected and a slurry of dung is fed. The biogas plant consists of a concrete tank that is 10 to 15 feet deep in which bio waste are collected and a slurry of dung is fed. A floating cover gives over the slurry only. Why this floating cover is given? Because while gas is producing from this slurry, then it should not be, pressure will be there. Gas producing means pressure will be there. So if it is fixed at one place, it will be break because of pressure. So floating cover only given on the slurry, which keeps on rising as the gas is produced in the tank. Understood? Which keeps on rising as the gas is produced in the tank due to the microbial activity. The biogas plant has an outlet which is connected to a pipe to supply biogas to nearby houses. The biogas plant has an outlet also. This one. The spent slurry is removed through another outlet and may be used as fertilizer. The spent slurry is removed through another outlet. And it is used for agriculture as a fertilizer. The cattle dung is available in large quantities in rural areas. Where cattle are used for a variety of purposes. So biogas plants are more often built in rural areas. Cattle dung is available in large quantities in rural areas, where cattle are used for a variety of purposes. The biogas thus produced is used for cooking and lighting only. The picture of a biogas plant is shown in figure 10.8. The technology of biogas production was developed in India mainly due to efforts of Indian Agricultural Research Institute IARI and Khadi and Village Industries Commission KVIC, Village Industries Commission. If your school is situated in a village or near a village, we can also visit to biogas plant. Visit the biogas plant and learn more about like that. And guidance also, one project work is also given to you. But in the context of Corona, we cannot be doing anything more. So now we are discussing this dung water digest gas is producing here. This is the gas holder. Sludge is going by another outlet. Sludge, dung water, sludge. In this digestion is taking place. As a result, the gas produced and the gas is given by the pipeline. Understood. So this topic we have learned in microbes in production of biogas only. We had learned in microbes in production of biogas, very important and easy also. And next topic we are going to discuss is microbes as biocontrol agents. Microbes we are using as, see that how many uses are there for the microbes. Microbes are using biocontrol agents. In agriculture, there is a method of controlling pests that relies on natural predation rather than introduced chemicals. In agriculture, there is a method of controlling pests that relies on natural predation rather than introduced chemicals. It is best for agricultural crop, for eating purpose, edible it is. So for eating purpose, when we are using, so much chemical is using on the food is not good for our health. So instead of using chemicals, natural predators can be used for killing the pest. A key belief of the organic farmer is that biodiversity pervades health. Biodiversity, different type of organism are there. Food chain, we had already learned that. So one organism can be used to destroy the other organism. The more variety the landscape has, the more sustainable it is. The organic farmer therefore works to create a system where the insects that are sometimes called pests are not eradicated, but instead are kept at manageable levels by a complex system of checks and balances within a living and vibrant ecosystem. This is good. The organic farmer therefore works to create a system where the insects are not totally killed. And sometimes pests are also not eradicated totally, but instead it keep at a manageable level only, not eradicated fully. Then that food chain will be break. If it is completely eradicated, then what will be happen? Food chain will be break. So the organic farmer therefore works to create a system where the insects that are sometimes called pests are not eradicated, but instead are kept at manageable levels by a complex system of checks and balances. Check means stopping and balancing the number of the organism within a living and vibrant ecosystem. Within a living and active ecosystem. Vibrant means active ecosystem. Contrary to the conventional farming practices, which often use chemical methods to kill both the useful and harmful life forms indiscriminately, this is a holistic approach that seeks to develop an understanding of the webs of interaction between the myriad of organisms that constitutes the field of fauna and the flora. This is a holistic approach that seeks to develop an understanding of the depths of interaction between the myriad of organisms that constitutes the field of fauna and the flora. The organic farmer holds the view that The eradication of the creatures that are often described as pests is not only possible but also undesirable, for without them the beneficial predatory and parasitic insects which depend upon them as the food or host would not be able to survive. If we are killing all the predators or pests like that, so the organism which we are living upon that as a food, how they will be able? Suppose that we are destroying all the plants, then how we will be eat? Then we will also die. So don't think that if to eradicate all the pests and insects, if all the pests and insects are eradicated, then what will be happen? The organism depending upon them as a food also will be destroyed. Thus the use of biocontrol measure, only control the number of organism measures, will greatly reduce our dependence on toxic chemicals and pesticides. An important part of the biological farming approach is to become familiar with the various life forms that inhabit the field, predators as well as the pests. To become familiar with the various life forms that inhabit the field, predators as well as pests, and also their life cycles, patterns of feeding, and the habitat that they prefer. Patterns of feeding and the habitats that they prefer. This will help develop appropriate means of biocontrol. The very familiar beetle with the red and black markings, ladybird and dragonflies, are useful to get rid of aphids and mosquitoes. Examples you have to buy hard. So objective questions will be asked like this. Or on the with subjective answers also you have to write the examples. So the ladybird and dragonflies are used to get rid of aphids and mosquitoes. An example of microbial biocontrol agents that can be introduced in order to control butterfly caterpillar is the bacteria Bacillus thuringiensis. Bacillus thuringiensis. These are available in sachets as dried spores. These are available in sachets as dried spores, which are mixed with water and sprayed onto vulnerable plants such as brassicas and fruit trees, where these are eaten by the insect larvae. In the gut of the larvae, the toxin is released and the larvae get killed. In the gut of the larvae, the toxin is released and the larvae get killed. The bacterial disease will kill the caterpillar but leave other insects unharmed. Bacterial disease killing the caterpillar only. It is not disturbing the others and larvae get killed. The bacterial disease will kill the caterpillar but leave the other insects unharmed only, because they cannot be affected. Bacteria cannot affect the other organism. The bacteria only affecting the caterpillar. Because of the development of the methods of genetic engineering in the last decade or so, the scientists have introduced Bacillus thuringiensis. Bacillus thuringiensis toxin genes into plants. Such plants are resistant to attack by insect pests. Bt cotton is one such example, which is being cultivated in some state of our country. So in the biotechnology, genetic engineering, biotechnology lessons are given. In that lesson, we will be learned more about this. A biological control being developed for use in the treatment of plant diseases, the fungus Trichoderma. Trichoderma species are free-living fungi that are very common in the root ecosystem. They are effective biocontrol agents of several plant pathogens. Fungus Trichoderma. Trichoderma species are free-living fungi that are very common in the root ecosystem. Baculoviruses are pathogens. Baculoviruses are pathogens that attack insects and other arthropods. Baculoviruses are pathogens and attack insects and other arthropods. Majority of baculoviruses used as biological control agents are in the genus Nucleopolyhedroviruses. Nucleopolyhedroviruses. These viruses are excellent candidates for species-specific narrow-spectrum insecticidal applications. They have been shown to have no negative impacts on plants, mammals, birds, fish, or even non-target insects. This whole pest are attacking only target insect. It is not disturbing the other insects present in the same ecosystem. That is desirable. This is especially desirable when beneficial insects are being conserved to aid in an overall integrated pest management program, or when an ecologically sensitive area is being treated. So, two topics we had included. Both the topics are very important: only biological control of pest and disease, and treatment of sewage.